All right. Go ahead and turn in your Bibles to the book of Habakkuk, and I'll give you a minute or two to find that. And that should give everybody enough time to tune in. You know, it might take 10 or 15 minutes to find the book of Habakkuk, so. All right, looks like people are finding it. It looks like it's working all right. Glad to see that. All right, the book of Habakkuk. Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk. It's one of those small books in the Old Testament, only has three chapters. It's got three chapters crammed full of all kinds of things. And I'm going to be teaching and preaching out of the book of Habakkuk this morning. So go ahead and get to Habakkuk. And before we get started, let's open in a word of prayer. Please join me as we pray and ask the Lord's blessing on the teaching this morning. Father, I come before you this morning. I do thank you, God, for the privilege it is to open a Bible. And even though we're separated at this time, hopefully it'll only be temporary. We pray, Father, that you'd feed us this morning, even though it is online, even though it is live streaming. Father, I believe that your word is more than capable of ministering to your people, even in this new technological method. I pray that you'd speak through me this morning. Help me, God, to have my mind just clear with this. Help me, Lord, to be clear and concise and understandable in what it is I believe you've given me this morning to try to get across. I believe this is important, and I pray that you bless your word this morning, and I believe by faith that you will do that, Father. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thanks for tuning in this morning. Glad to have you. Hopefully this coronavirus stuff won't be lasting for much longer, but we will see. So go ahead and turn to the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk is a small Old Testament book, but like I said, it's a very interesting one, cram-packed with all kinds of information. Now, there's very little in the book of Habakkuk itself that tells us any clues as to when Habakkuk was alive and when he prophesied, except that his prophecies in this book revolve around the coming destruction of Jerusalem at the hand of Babylon and the eventual destruction of Babylon. And the Babylonian invasions of Israel and Jerusalem began in 606 BC, which means that Habakkuk prophesied sometime before that. Obviously, in order to be a prophet of what's coming, it had to have been before that. So some say that he was a prophet during the reign of Josiah, which would put him in 650 BC. Some say that he's a contemporary of Jeremiah and saw Jerusalem's invasion in 606 BC. And depending on how old he lived to be, both could be true, but more than likely, God gave Habakkuk these visions around the time of Josiah's revival. Now, at that time in history, Babylon was an ascending great empire, but they were very far away, and no one in Judea was worried about the Babylonians. Josiah, the king at that time in Israel, had decided that he was going to clean up this town, and he had a MIGA campaign, Make Israel Great Again. And what he was doing was he destroyed all the idols, he burnt down the pagan groves, he removed the Baalite priests, he broke down the high places of satanic ritualistic sacrifices, he bulldozed the houses of the Sodomites, amen, and he renewed the Lord's covenant with the people. And you can read all about that in the book of Kings. And things were going really well, which is why Habakkuk, when he got this vision, things were going really, really good in Josiah's day, probably when Habakkuk got this vision. It was going so well that when Habakkuk got this vision of Babylon destroying Jerusalem, it completely shocked him. And that's what you get in chapter 1. And Habakkuk doesn't understand why the Lord is showing me iniquity and causing me to behold grievance and all this stuff. All right, now, the destruction of Israel at the hands of Babylon is exactly what happened later on. The revival under Josiah, and remember this, the revival under Josiah was not a real revival. It was a forced revival. Josiah himself had a personal revival and got right with God, but the people did not. The people showed no signs of repentance. They just had to go along with what the king was doing and pretend to be excited about it. And as soon as King Josiah was dead, the people went straight back to their idolatry. And in Habakkuk chapter 2, the Lord reveals to Habakkuk the wickedness of Babylon. He speaks against the king, Nebuchadnezzar. He speaks against the city of Babylon. And I'm going to go kind of fast. Go to Habakkuk chapter 2. This is all introductory stuff, but I want you to kind of get the feel and the context of what the Lord is talking about here in Habakkuk chapter 2. And in verse 5, it says, "Yea, also, because he transgresseth by wine, he is a proud man, neither keepeth at home, who enlargeth his desire as hell, and is as death, and cannot be satisfied, but gathereth unto him all the nations, and heapeth unto him all people." So the Babylonian monster has basically begun to grow. Babylon had overthrown the great Assyrian Empire that preceded it. They had overthrown the capital of Nineveh in 612 BC. They had thrown off the Assyrian rule, and now Babylon was the king and the country that was in charge and becoming a great world power. And after Babylon defeated Assyria, they became unstoppable and began to devour every city and nation that stood in their path. And then in verse 6 it says, "Shall not all these take up a parable against him and a taunting proverb against him and say, Woe to him that increaseth that which is not his. How long? And to him that ladeth himself with thick clay. Shall they not rise up suddenly that shall bite thee? And awake that shall vex thee, and thou shalt be for booties unto them? Because thou hast spoiled many nations, all the remnant of the people shall spoil thee, because of men's blood, and for the violence of the land, of the city, and of all that dwell therein." So God is saying that because of Babylon's violence against these cities, and Jerusalem specifically, God would eventually raise up a nation that would suddenly defeat Babylon. Which is exactly what happened. The army of the Medes and the Persians took the city of Babylon, the capital city state there. In history, they took the Babylonian Empire in one night, in 536 BC. And that story is described in Daniel chapter 5 with Belshazzar and the handwriting of the wall and all that story. Then it says in verse 9, "Woe to him that coveteth an evil covetousness to his house, that he may set his nest on high, that he may be delivered from the power of evil." Now this verse quickly gives the three reasons why a nation instigates war against another nation. Number one, covetousness. They want what the other nation has. Number two, pride. They want to be on top. They want to be number one. They want to be the world empire. Number three, security. It's a preemptive strike against an enemy that it keeps him from attacking you later on. So while your enemy is weak, you just go and crush them so that way they can't come and get you later. And kind of like what Caesar did with the Gauls. And then in verse 10, it says that thou hast consulted shame to thy house by cutting off many people and hast sinned against thy soul. So God is going to punish Babylon for her violence and her bloodshed. And then in verse 11 it says, "For the stone shall cry out of the wall, and the beam out of the timber shall answer it." I have no idea what that verse is talking about. I don't even have a clue. So if you can enlighten me and tell me what verse 11 is talking about, I'd be grateful, but I don't know. Verse 12, "Woe to him that buildeth a town with blood and establisheth a city by iniquity." Kind of like we built this city on rock and roll type thing. Verse 13, it says, "Behold, it is not of the is it not of the Lord of hosts that the people shall labor in the very fire, and the people shall weary themselves for very vanity?" All right, so what's going on here? Babylon is a town that it was builded by blood and established by iniquity. They got their wealth and became great by stealing from other nations and destroying other nations and stealing their wealth. And in verse 13, it might have to do with God's punishment of his people, the Jews, for their sin and idolatry. Okay, so in other words, God is saying, you Babylonians are boasting over destroying my people. The only reason why they're your slaves is because I wanted them to be punished for their sin. And then he proceeds to point out to Babylon in verse 14, for the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. So the idea is, you know, Jerusalem may be subservient to Babylon right now, but in the future, Israel will be on top and God will be their king. Israel will come back even though they've been destroyed by the Babylonians. All right, verse 15. This is where I'm going to park today. Verse 15, it says, woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, that puttest thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. Thou art filled with shame for glory. Drink thou also, and let thy foreskin be uncovered. The cup of the Lord's right hand shall be turned unto thee, and shameful spewing shall be on thy glory. For the violence of Lebanon in the Bible, that's kind of another name for Israel. For the violence of Israel, what you did to my people, basically. For the violence of Babylon shall cover thee, and the spoil of beasts, which made them afraid, because of men's blood, and for the violence of the land, Jerusalem, or Israel, of the city, Jerusalem, and of all that dwell therein, the Jews. All right, so God is basically threatening Babylon, saying, hey, you destroyed my people, I'm going to destroy you. You know, and he's saying that Babylon is a wicked empire. So this is the vision against the ancient city of Babylon. And before we get into the thick of this lesson, let me quickly point out the three woes here. Notice in verse 9, it says, woe to him that coveteth an evil covetousness to his house. And verse 12 says, woe to him that buildeth a town with blood. And verse 15 says, woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink. So you have woe, 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 which is interesting. You have something like that in the book of Revelation, have to do with the tribulation period and mystery Babylon. But verse 9 is, woe to him that is consumed with covetousness. Verse 12 is, woe to him that indulges in iniquity. And verse 15 is, woe to him that is drunken with drink. And these three woes, by the way, are still in effect today. God's word has not changed when it comes to these three things. Covetousness is still a sin that the Bible calls idolatry in the New Testament. Iniquity in the Bible is unconfessed sin that piles up and piles up and piles up until finally God's hammer of judgment falls. Wine is still wicked, and Proverbs 20 verse 1 is still true. Wine is still a mocker. Strong drink is still raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is still not wise. All right, now I want to focus on verse 15. Woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, that puttest thy bottle to him, and mayest and puttest thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. Now, the Bible is very plain, isn't it? I'm sure you don't have any trouble understanding what Habakkuk 2:15 means, do you? That verse actually might be a little bit too plain for some. Now, the personal, individual application is very obvious and very plain, and this type of sin happens all the time in every bar somewhere. A guy gets a girl drunk so he can get her naked, and God hates that. And it should go without saying, but girls, if you're listening, do not trust any man with a bottle of wine in his hand. Period. Do not trust him. Listen, drinking alcohol is a sin that causes you to commit more sin. You can try to squiggle and squirm all you want, but over and over in the Bible, fermented wine is a bad thing that causes all kinds of destruction. Just look around society and tell me with a straight face that in our country, we're better off with the legal distribution and consumption of liquor. Go ahead, try to tell me that. You say, well, once prohibition was repealed, the mob stopped killing people. Yeah, and now gangs kill each other over cocaine and LSD. There's always going to be something that criminals are going to be killing each other over. And now, because it's legalized, 10 times more people die every year in alcohol-related auto accidents than were ever killed by the mob. The number really is probably more like 100 times more. On December 5th, 1933, the 21st Amendment that made the sale and consumption of alcohol legal was ratified by President Roosevelt, which means on December 5th, 1933, the United States decided that God didn't know what he was talking about when it comes to the subject of alcohol. And America thought they were smarter than God. And there's a lot of Christians these days who also think that they're smarter than God when it comes to alcohol, but don't worry. They too will soon eventually discover their own folly. Because the Bible says you're not wise if you're deceived by that. Now that's the individual application of the verse, but what I want to show you today is the international aspect of this verse. Because what we're dealing with here, you have to acknowledge that in the context, we're talking about Babylon. The entire thing in this passage, in Habakkuk 2:15, God is giving you an allegory of something that he's trying to get across in relation to the city empire of Babylon. The entire context is ancient Babylon and their violent treatment of Israel. Look at verse 15 through 17, we've read it, but it's talking about giving your neighbor drink and making him drunken so that you can look on their nakedness, okay? Now, intoxicating wine, drunkenness, nakedness, all of these things are representative of something that happened between these two nations, Babylon and Israel. Now, this may seem very cryptic at first, but once you understand the code of God's parables, this passage will start to make perfect sense as to what God is trying to get across. Obviously, there's a warning against drinking alcohol here and all these types of things, but there's more to it than that, and that's what I'm going to try to show you today. This is a very interesting subject. Hold your finger there in Habakkuk chapter 2 and turn to Ezekiel chapter 16. Ezekiel chapter 16. Now, obviously, that passage in Habakkuk 2:15 is talking about getting someone drunk to make that person naked. So there is going to be some adult-type information here this morning, but I'll try to be discreet, okay? Because I know there might be some kids watching. But in Ezekiel chapter 16, in this chapter, God is talking about Jerusalem. He talks about how Jerusalem was a dirty, bloody dump of a city. But he took it to himself, and he made it into a beautiful city, okay? And in the Bible, the covenant relationship between a city or a nation and their God is likened to the relationship of a husband and a wife. You want to get that, because when you're reading through the Old Testament, you see this come up a lot. And God says, I've divorced my people over there in Hosea. What did he do? He cast off the city. All right, so in the parables, in the Old Testament, in the allegories, God or the deity, okay, we'll say deity, of a city is the husband, and the wife is essentially the city, okay, or the nation. So when it comes to these Old Testament allegories, keep that in mind. The god or the idol of a nation is the husband, and the city itself is the wife. And so the city and their god is likened to a covenant marriage relationship. For example, Amun-Ra was the god of Egypt. Egypt would be the wife, and Amun-Ra would be the husband. Jehovah was the god of Israel. Jehovah would be like the husband, Israel would be like the wife, you understand? So God chose Jerusalem, this city, for himself. And he likens that to a marriage in Ezekiel 16, and he adorns his bride, if you will, with all kinds of riches, wealth, and splendor. It says there in Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 7, he says, I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field, and thou hast increased and waxen great, and thou art come to excellent ornaments. Thy breasts are fashioned, and thy hair is grown, whereas thou wast naked and bare. Okay, he's talking about a city of Jerusalem. She was naked and bare. In other words, the city was tiny, it was defenseless, it was a total dump. But then God chose her, and in Ezekiel 16, 9 through 14, look what happens. I'll read it quickly. Then washed I thee with water. Yea, I thoroughly washed away thy blood from thee, and I anointed thee with oil. I clothed thee also with broidered work, and shod thee with badger skins, and I girded thee about with fine linen, and I covered thee with silk. I decked thee also with ornaments, and I put bracelets upon thy hands, and a chain upon thy neck. And I put a jewel on thy forehead, and earrings in thine ears, and a beautiful crown upon thy head. Now you understand, this is not an actual person here. This is the city of Jerusalem. It's an anthropomorphic, as the term, type thing, where it's likening a city to a person. Okay, you understand this is a parable. And he says, verse 13, thus wast thou decked with gold and silver, and thy raiment was of fine linen and silk and broidered work. Thou didst eat fine flour and honey and oil, and thou wast exceeding was perfect through my comeliness, which I had put upon thee, saith the Lord, Lord God. So Jerusalem was the jewel of the earth, basically during Solomon's reign. That was the golden age of Israel. And it could be argued that no king in history has ever been as rich as Solomon was. And what God's describing here, decking Jerusalem with gold and silver, this is probably a reference to the son of David, king of Israel, King Solomon, and his reign, and that great splendor that Israel had. Jerusalem had incredible prosperity. But what happened? Well, King Solomon fell into idolatry, and the people of Jerusalem did too. Now, that's important to remember. Saul, King Saul, the first king of Israel, he was not an idolater. King David, who came after Saul, he wasn't an idolater either. But Solomon, the third king to take the throne of Jerusalem, he fell into idolatry. He introduced idolatry into Israel, and the idolatry was preceded by prosperity. Remember that. Jerusalem's worship of other gods is likened to adultery. So you have Mrs. Jerusalem, let's just say, cheating on God, her husband. How? By spiritually fornicating with or worshiping idols. You see, when the Jews of Jerusalem turned away from their husband and turned to other husbands, other gods, idols, it's likened to spiritual adultery or spiritual fornication. Look at verse 15. But thou didst trust in thine own beauty, and playest the harlot because of thy renown, and pourest out thy fornications on every one that passed by, his it was. Basically, any city or nation nearby, they were worshiping those idols. They were taking those idols to them. You remember that Solomon had 700 wives and or 300 concubines, and he had all these women, and he was taking their idols to them. And basically, no matter what town it was, come on in, let's take in your idols. And so they were worshiping all these different gods, and he likens her to a whore. And so in these parables, the city and the nation is usually representative of a woman. But when it comes to now what's going to happen in these verses, when it comes to another nation, sometimes God will liken other cities and nations to men, to other men, aggressive men. Look at verse 26, for example. All right. So Jerusalem is fornicating with all these other husbands, all these other gods. And look what's going to happen. Verse 26. Thou hast also committed fornication with the Egyptians, thy neighbors. Okay, well, that's another kingdom. But it's likened to a man. Okay, the Egyptians. Great of flesh, and hast increased thy whoredoms to provoke me to anger. So spiritual fornication between nations involves two things. There's a religious aspect, primarily, that involves worshiping of the gods of those other countries. And then there's also an economic aspect. You need to get that. When it comes to spiritual, allegorical fornication between nations, there's a religious aspect, primarily, and also an economic aspect. It has to do with religion and money, two very powerful and influential things among nations. Jerusalem's spiritual fornication with other nations wasn't just with their idols, but the spiritual fornication involved teaming up with other nations, forming alliances with other nations, and joining other nations, whether it be in battle or commerce or so on. And so in the Bible, God is for national sovereignty and separation, but when nations start getting together and interconnecting their economies, they naturally interconnect their religions, okay? And so spiritually, in the spiritual realm, if you will, the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, the World Council of Churches, okay? These global things that are getting together, they're essentially, to be as discreet as possible, they are spiritual harlot houses, okay, between the nations. They're all getting together, and God doesn't like that. Now, while you're cleaning up the coffee that you just spit out of your mouth, I'll read you what the Bible says here in verse 35 through 39. All right, good morning. I'm sure you didn't expect a Bible study like this morning, but this is good because there's a lot of this kind of thing in the Bible, and you need to understand this concept that God puts across very frequently. All right, verse 35, I'll read it quickly. Wherefore, O harlot, speaking to Jerusalem, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God, because thy filthiness was poured out and thy nakedness discovered through thy whoredoms with thy lovers, the neighboring nations, and with all the idols of thy abominations, and by the blood of thy children which thou didst give unto them. Behold, therefore, I will gather all thy lovers with whom thou hast taken pleasure, and all them that thou hast loved with all them that thou hast hated. I will even gather them round about against thee, and will discover thy nakedness unto them, that they may see all thy nakedness. And I will judge thee as women that break wedlock and shed blood are judged. And I will give thee blood and fire and fury and jealousy. And I will also give thee into their hand, and they shall throw down thine eminent place, and shall break down thy high places. Now look at this. They shall strip thee also of thy clothes, and shall take thy fair jewels, and leave thee naked and bare. Okay? Now remember, this is talking about a city, but there's an allegory going on here. And so God is going to cause these surrounding nations that Israel has been joining up with and worshiping their gods, Jerusalem's lovers, they're going to come back and they're going to, let me write it here, they're going to come back and they're going to beat her, they're going to strip her, all right, and they're going to destroy her. Now, this is a city, remember. This is likening to a city. So when a nation does these things to another nation, beats her, beats down the walls, strips her, takes her wealth, and destroys her, kills her people, when a nation does this to another nation, it is the allegorical equivalent of rape. All right, now the Bible word is force, so that's the word I'm going to be using throughout this lesson just for the sake of being discreet. But so you understand what I'm talking about, total massacre of a city, even in the history textbooks, is dubbed a rape of a city. You think about the Japanese destroying the Chinese people. They killed hundreds of thousands of Chinese back in the late 1930s, I think it was. And if you look up that event anywhere online, that thing is called the Rape of Nanking. All right, so that's even something that's used in our modern history books, okay? So I'm not trying to be crude, but that's just a word. That's just the reality of the situation. Unfortunately, those things happen. But these complete massacres of a city is likened to forcing a woman. Okay. Now the Bible indicates in various places that forcing a woman is akin to murder. Now don't worry, I'm not going to get. Like I said, I'm going to stay discreet. But there's something you need to understand here. Deuteronomy 22:26 says, speaking of this subject, for as when a man riseth against his neighbor and slayeth him. Even so is this matter. So murder is the destruction of the body. Forcing is the destruction of the human spirit. It destroys the mind. Forcing a person is humbling and humiliating to that victim and brings their mind as low as it can possibly go, short of being dead. Now, like I said, I don't say that to be gross or vile, but there's an allegory here that God is likening this to. And you need to understand that in order to know what God's talking about. Forcing is complete defilement and destruction short of total annihilation. Okay, so understand that. Total annihilation would be likening a city murdering another nation. That city just ceases to exist and it's just gone. That would be like murder. Okay, but when a city is taken, the people are taken captive, you know, and led away, and the people are still, maybe there's still some survivors there in the city, but the entire thing is burned to the ground. There's dead corpses everywhere. There's trenches filled with corpses and blood running in the streets. That's likened to the forcing of a woman. That's what the Bible likens that to. All right, so that's what Babylon did to Jerusalem. They defiled, they stole, and destroyed everything. They entered into the temple. They defiled Jerusalem. But there were some survivors still left in the city. Jerusalem was not murdered. The Jewish people survived, but she experienced a forcing that is akin to murder. forcing in the Bible carries the death sentence with it, just like murder. All right, so do you understand the concept now? All right, now back to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. All right. Mr. Babylon had evil intentions toward Mrs. Jerusalem. Mr. Babylon wanted to make Mrs. Jerusalem naked. Babylon wanted to take Jerusalem's clothes. And you remember from Ezekiel chapter 16 that the clothing of a nation, the clothing of a city, was its riches, was its wealth, was all the luxuries of that country. It's likened to beautiful adornments of a woman. All right? Babylon wanted that. Babylon wanted to steal Jerusalem's wealth and riches. And from an allegorical aspect, it's likened to a person stealing someone else's clothes and making them naked. All right, Mr. Babylon wanted her and devised a way to get her. So Mr. Babylon's method was not unlike any other wicked man's method against a woman. He got her drunk. He wined and dined her, if you will. The question is, that I want you to start thinking about, Satan's strong drink is the name of this, is the title of this Bible study today. How did Babylon get Jerusalem drunk? What does that mean? What kind of fancy wine did Mr. Babylon offer Mrs. Jerusalem? What caused this spiritual drunkenness? Okay, because we're not dealing with physical drunkenness, you know, people actually, you know, intoxicated, stumbling around. This is a spiritual allegory that we have going on here. So what is the connection here? What's the parable? Well, the exact historical, biblical account of what happened when Mr. Babylon first laid eyes on Mrs. Jerusalem is found in 2 Kings chapter 20. Go ahead and hold your finger there in Habakkuk and look at 2 Kings chapter 20. All right. Now, we might go a little bit longer today. We got to start about 15 after, but we'll see. But 2 Kings chapter 20, all right? This was when Mr. Babylon first met Mrs. Jerusalem, and it was lust at first sight. 2 Kings chapter 20, you have the story of Hezekiah. He's king of Jerusalem, and he's on his deathbed, and he prays to God, and God heals him and grants him 15 more years of life. You remember the story. Verse 12, all right? Here's where, you know, where Mrs. Jerusalem and Mr. Babylon first meet. Verse 12. At that time, Berodach-Baladan, the son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent letters and a present unto Hezekiah, for he had heard that Hezekiah had been sick. All right? Letters and a present. That's very important. It's so important that I'm going to go and write right here, letters and a present. All right, letters and a present. If you had to take a wild guess as to what that present was, what do you think it was? The king of Babylon gives Hezekiah a present. What do you think it was? Well, undoubtedly, the present had to do with, you know, gold, rubies, maybe spices, maybe ornate apparel, gems, diamonds, silver. That's what nations give each other. Those are the presents that they give. You know, it was basically, the present undoubtedly was money. Okay? You see that throughout the Bible. Kings, you know, go into other kings and they're offering them riches. You got money, riches. The present was wealth. So it was letters and a present, or we might say it was words. Right? The letters. And wealth. Okay. Follow me here. Letters and a present, words and wealth. Now remember, this is what Mr. Babylon was flirting with Mrs. Jerusalem. Letters and words are likened to flattery, right? Letters and words are like flattery here, okay? He's wining and dining Jerusalem. The present and wealth is going to be the wine. In the world, you know, when a man wants to seduce a woman or whatever, there's always the flattery and there's the wine. And that throughout the Bible, flattery. With the flattering of her lips, she forced him. That type of thing. It works for men towards women too. flattery and wine. All right? So, the wealth was the wine, the words and the present. Letters and a present, words and wealth, flattery and wine. Mr. Babylon used his fine wealth wine to cause Mrs. Jerusalem to get a little tipsy. She's given the wealth, you know, all this money coming from Babylon, and she starts to feel a little bit of a buzz. You know, she reads the letters, you know, that King Berodach-Baladan had sent. Hezekiah reads those letters, and he hears the sweet words, you know, of the Babylonian ambassadors. And Mrs. Jerusalem's heart starts to flutter. Oh, Mr. Babylon, you say the nicest things. You know, what's interesting? The Bible says in Jeremiah 51, verse 7, Babylon hath been a certain kind of cup. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 7, it says, Babylon hath been a golden cup in the Lord's hand that made all the earth drunken. The nations have drunken of her wine, therefore the nations are mad. They're drunk. What kind of wine did Babylon have? Well, the fact that it's in a golden cup tells you what the wine is. It's riches. It's wealth. Same with Mystery Babylon. She has a golden cup in her hand that she deceives the nations with. It's a golden cup, and they drink it. What is the wine representative of? It's riches. It's wealth. Okay? Letters and a present. Words and wealth. Flattery and wine. All right, and so before long, Mrs. Jerusalem takes Mr. Babylon aside after she hears the letters. She receives the present. She gets the flattery. She gets the wine, you know, the flowers, the nice, lovely dinner from the Babylonian ambassadors. And so she gets kind of swept off her feet and a little tipsy and takes Mr. Babylon aside and shows him her secrets. Look at verse 13. And Hezekiah hearkened unto them and showed them all the house of his precious things, the silver and the gold and the spices and the precious ointment, and all the house of his armor and all that was found in his treasures. There was nothing in his house nor in all his dominion that Hezekiah showed them not. Do you understand what's happening here on a spiritual, allegorical level? What God is seeing in the spiritual realm, what's going on here. All of this stuff that Hezekiah was showing the Babylonians is Jerusalem's clothing, according to Ezekiel 16. Hezekiah has taken off Jerusalem's clothes for the Babylonians. You say, oh, but wait, you know, it's her body and she can do what she wants with it, right? No. Look at verse 14. Then came Isaiah the prophet unto King Hezekiah and said unto him, after this all happens and the Babylonians leave, here comes the prophet, you know, raining on Hezekiah's parade. And he says unto him, what said these men, and from whence came they unto thee? And Hezekiah said, they are come from a far country, even from Babylon. You know, oh, they're far away, don't worry about it. And he said, what have they seen in thine house? And Hezekiah answered, all the things that are in mine house have they seen. There is nothing among my treasures that I have not showed them. Stripped naked, completely bare, no clothes on. And Isaiah said unto Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord. Behold, the days come that all that is in thine house and that which thy fathers have laid up in store unto this day shall be carried into Babylon. Nothing shall be left, saith the Lord. In other words, it was like Isaiah was saying, Hezekiah, you idiot, you willfully showed them the nakedness of Jerusalem, and someday they are going to come back, and the next time they do, they are going to strip you, they are going to beat you, and they are going to force you, and Jerusalem will be destroyed. You see the connection? Mrs. Jerusalem showed her nakedness, which is exactly what Babylon was going for. This is exactly what the Clintons did with the USA towards the Chinese during the Clinton administration. Just showing all of America's secrets to the Chinese. And that's what the Chinese wanted. Why? So they can destroy you later. Or try to. That's the goal, anyway, of these nations. The Babylonians spied on Jerusalem. They saw everything they wanted to see. And then from that point forward, they plotted on how to take everything that Jerusalem had. The Babylonians used words and wealth to get Jerusalem to let their guard down. Do you understand? That was the wine. That was the drink that they offered to trick her. It was the flattery, and the wealth was the wine. Okay? They used words and wealth to get Jerusalem to let down their guard. The enemy used words and wealth to deceive, with the goal to eventually destroy. Okay? You deceive the person, get them drunk, get them naked, and then you force them. It's a destruction. Right? Letters and a present as the means of deception. That's what the Babylonians were doing to Hezekiah. They were deceiving him. Words and wealth. Look at Proverbs chapter 23. You say, what does this have to do with anything? You'll see. You'll see. Proverbs chapter 23, because Satan's methods haven't changed, even against you. Okay? Proverbs chapter 23. But right now we're on the subject of international foreign relations. All right, Proverbs chapter 23, verse 1. When thou sittest to eat with a ruler, the Babylonian ambassadors were representatives of the ruler of Babylon. Okay. Consider diligently what is before thee. Proverbs 23, verse 2. And put a knife to thy throat, if thou be a man given to appetite. Be not desirous of his dainties, for they are deceitful meat. He's trying to deceive you. What exactly are the ruler's dainties? Well, it's in the passage, dainties are probably exotic foods and wine. Okay, and wine. But how about we read the next verse and see what the dainties might be? Verse 4, labor not to be rich. Cease from thine own wisdom. Well, here comes the wealth. Interesting. The dainties, the exotic foods and wine, cheese and wine. And what is it linked to? Riches, money, wealth. Wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away as an eagle toward heaven. Eat thou not the bread of him that hath an evil eye, neither desire thou his dainty meats. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, saith he to thee. There's the words. There's the letters. Okay? But his heart is not with thee. Letters and a present. Words and wine. Okay? And he says, but his heart is not with thee. The morsel which thou hast eaten shalt thou vomit up and lose thy sweet words. He gives you the wealth and the words to deceive you, but later on he takes back his wealth and words from you and destroys you. All of the wealth that Babylon gave to Hezekiah in 2 Kings chapter 20, it was no big deal giving Hezekiah all this money, all this present, all this letters, because the Babylonians were planning on coming and taking it all back. You understand? They tricked him. Letters and a present to deceive. Words and wealth to deceive. Flattery and wine to deceive. Isaiah 19:14. Well, it says, by the way, I wanted to say this. A spirit of deception, when a person is completely deceived, it's likened to drunkenness in the Bible. Isaiah 19:14, I'll read it. It says, the Lord hath mingled a perverse mingle. That's what you do with a drink, a strong drink. The Lord hath mingled a perverse spirit in the midst thereof, and they have caused Egypt to err in every work thereof, as a drunken man staggereth in his vomit. So when a nation starts making every single possible mistake you can, and every single thing they do is wrong, It's a perverse spirit that God has given to that nation or to that person. It's likened to a drunken man. A drunken man can't do anything right. You know, everything he does is backwards. He's staggering around. He can barely do anything right. I would say that the Lord has given the Democratic Party a spirit of drunkenness. They literally can't get anything right. They can barely even speak. I believe the Lord has given them a perverse spirit. He's mingled it in there. Now, you don't have to agree with me, but that's my opinion. The Democrats can't do anything right. The Barack Obama in his last administration, he couldn't do anything right. It was like every single thing that was done was just a total disaster. Okay? and the wrong move, okay? And when that happens, you're dealing with a nation that's been cursed by God and has been given over to a spirit of deception where they can't discern truth from error, right from wrong, and everything they do is wrong, and the Bible likens it to drunkenness, all right? So wine is connected to a deceiving spirit. When you go to the grocery store and you're going to buy some wine, not that you're going to, if you're a Christian, I don't believe you should, but if you're at a grocery, or when people go to the grocery store, it says there wine and spirits. Why does everybody, even subconsciously, connect alcohol, fermented liquor, with spirit, like a ghost, like a demon? Where'd that connection come from? It comes from the Bible. It should be called wine and deceiving spirits, is what it should be written on there. Deceiving spirits. Wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. You know, Jesus talked about the deceitfulness of riches. Riches, remember? In the Bible, what I'm trying to show you is that wine is a type of wealth. Riches. Riches are a type of wine. You got to be careful with it. Okay? All right. So let's keep going. Deception is the spiritual equivalent of drunkenness. You know what the devil is interested in doing? He's interested in deceiving you. If Satan deceives you, Christian, he has made you drunk spiritually. Okay? And what kind of spiritual wine does the devil like to use to deceive God's people? Words and wealth. He will use that wine to mess you up. Flattery, words, and wine, wealth. And that's what I've been preaching these last few weeks. I thought I was done with this subject, but God gave me something else here in my Bible reading. And this sermon today is essentially Preparing for Prosperity Part 3. Sorry, but this is what the Lord gave me, so I'm not really sorry. But letters and a present from the devil, words and wealth. Recall what I taught you in Preparing for Prosperity Part 2, and how I showed you that Solomon is a type of the devil there, and the Queen of Sheba was a type of the church. Do you remember what Solomon gave to the Queen of Sheba? Two things. He gave her his wisdom, words, and he gave her his royal bounty, wealth. Oh, very interesting. What is it that Satan uses to deceive the Laodicean church in the last days of the church age? Well, you want to take a guess? 1 Timothy 4, verse 1, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." He uses words in the last days to mess up the church. Deceiving spirits, doctrines of devils. That's words. Doctrines, letters. Okay. The second one is wealth. Revelation 3:14, "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing." Where do you think all that wealth came from? The devil, maybe. Wisdom and his royal bounty. Letters to Laodicea and a present. Oh, thank you. From the devil. Here's a little interesting factoid from history. The ancient city of Laodicea, you know, we read about the church of the Laodiceans there in Revelation chapter 3. That's named after an ancient city in Asia Minor. The ancient city of Laodicea was named after a woman. That's where the word comes from. Laodicea was the name of a woman. Her name was Laodice, and she was a queen of the Seleucid Empire after Alexander the Great died. Of all things, Laodicea is likened to a woman. She's likened to a queen. And Jesus says he loves her in verse 19. What I'm trying to show you is the last days of the church age, the Christians as a whole, think of them like a woman, okay? It's the bride of Christ, right? Jesus is the husband, and the church, the body of Christ, the saved Christians around the world, they're likened to a woman. And this covenant relationship of Christians to Jesus Christ is like that of a marriage. You find that in the Bible, and it's till death do us part. And since Jesus Christ will never die, and since we were given eternal life when we got saved, we will never be separated from the love of Christ. Amen. Till death do us part, we're never going to die. So we're never going to part. Thank God. The Laodicean church represents the Christians in the last days. They're likened to the espoused wife of Jesus Christ. Espoused, like you're engaged. The marriage hasn't happened yet. Remember, the marriage is consummated at the rapture. And then heaven's kind of like the honeymoon or something to that effect. But toward the end of this engagement, okay, when Jesus returns at the rapture, that's the marriage when the man and the woman come together. Okay? But up until that point, the last 2,000 years has been likened to an engagement. Though, like I told you before, the Lord gave the church his engagement ring, his promise, the Holy Spirit of promise. We're sealed until the day of redemption. Jesus promised he's going to come back. He sent his comforter, okay? The Holy Spirit. All right, now, toward the end of this long engagement period where the woman is waiting for the man to return, you know, he's gone off to his father's kingdom to build a home. He's going to build a mansion for his wife. He's building a house, and when the house is ready, he's going to come and get the woman. Okay? Toward the end of this engagement, it's been going on and dragging on for a long time. You know, where is Jesus? It's been a while. Well, there's a problem. And the problem is this. Mr. Leviathan has his eye on Mrs. Laodicea. And he has evil intentions for her. He wants to defile and destroy her. That's what he wants. He can't annihilate her. God won't allow that to happen. The devil is not going to be able to kill every single Christian on the earth and destroy the church. It's not going to happen. So he can't murder Laodicea in that sense. That's option number one. So that leaves him with option number two, the thing right next to murder. If you remember what that was from earlier. Do you remember what that thing right next to murder was that I showed you earlier in Deuteronomy? You say, surely not. Why would you put that past the devil? Do you think the devil has higher scruples than to attempt such a thing with Jesus' bride? His method against the church, and you know that's what he's going for, because his method against the church has been to intoxicate, defile, and destroy. That's been Satan's method since the beginning. Intoxicate, defile, and destroy. Think of it. Wasn't Adam a type of Christ? Then who do you suppose Eve, the woman who was holy and without blemish, who do you think she was a type of? Well, she's the type of the church. Okay? And you can bet your bank account that the fruit Satan offered Eve and deceived her with from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was a grape. As in grape juice, as in wine, right? Wine and words, remember? Wine and words, letters and a present, wine and words. The wealth was the wine, okay? Wine and words. Yea, hath God said, the grape of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Intoxicate, she ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Messed with her mind, with her spirit. Defile, Cain is born, who the Bible says was of that wicked one. Destroy. Wherefore, sin entered into the world. Intoxicate, defile, destroy. It's likening to forcing a woman. It's destroying her. In the last days of the church, Satan has evil intentions for Jesus' woman. And he resorts to the same thing that worked with Eve. Words and wine. Except instead of literal wine, like it was for Eve, it's figurative wine, which is wealth. So with Eve, he used words, yea, hath God said, and wine, the grape of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. With the church, he uses words, false teaching, seducing spirits, doctrines of devils, maybe new Bible versions to trick you, and wealth, riches, letters and a present, sent from the devil himself. You say, what for? Why does Satan want to give words and wealth to the Laodicean church? to get Laodicea drunk. Through false doctrine and prosperity, Satan has deceived the church. She's drunk. She's deceived. That's what drunkenness is likened to. Drunkenness is likened to being deceived. Would you agree that the church in the last days is deceived? She's drunk. She's likened to a drunken woman. She got drunk because somebody's making her drunk. Somebody's tricking her. Okay? The end times begins with deception. The last 10 years of the tribulation period, that Jesus said, take heed that no man deceive you. That was the first thing Jesus said. It begins with deception, and the last days of the church ends with what? Deception. The church is deceived. Through words and wealth, Satan has gotten Jesus Christ's espoused bride drunk. And Laodicea is so drunk, she's made herself naked and doesn't even know it. She's a streaker. She's so sop drunk. She's drunk as a skunk. Thou sayest, Revelation 3, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. Drink in the wine, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. You know what happens when people get drunk? They get naked. Sometimes they don't even know they're naked. They're intoxicated. Lady, you're drunk. Satan has gotten the church drunk and naked. And what do you think he plans to do to her next? He plans to destroy her. Completely destroy her. That's what a wicked man does when he gets a woman naked and drunk. He's going to destroy her. And that's what Satan's going to try to do to the church. You say, well, will Jesus let that happen? I don't know. I don't think so. In my opinion, I don't think Jesus is going to let Satan fulfill his intentions that he would like to do to the church. And the reason why I think that is because of something I read over in Esther chapter 7. There's a type here, I think, where Esther is having a banquet of wine with Haman and Ahasuerus the king. And she has revealed that Haman is this enemy. And you remember the king goes out and steps outside to think about what he's going to do. And when he returns, when the king returns, the Bible says that he comes just in time to see that Haman, in chapter 7, verse 8 of Esther, says, Haman was fallen upon the bed where Esther was. Then said the king, will he force the queen also before me in the house? The king saw what was about to happen. He saw what was about to happen to his wife, his bride, and he stopped it right at the last second. As the word went out of the king's mouth, they covered Haman's face. All right? He saved the woman from the defilement right at the last second. And I kind of think that that might be what Jesus is going to do for the church. She's so drunk that the devil is going to try to completely destroy her and annihilate, basically, Christianity. Christians will still be alive, but all of Christianity is just complete disaster. It looks like that's what the devil is going to try to do. Now, this story with Esther, is that a type of the church about to be defiled and destroyed by Satan and Jesus comes to the rescue with the rapture? I don't know. I'm not really sure. But what I do know that what Satan is trying to do to God's people in the last days of the church. And so far, I will say he has been very successful in deceiving the church. I think we are at the very end of the church age, personally. And Laodicea is already buzzed. She's already pretty tipsy. But as the Lord tarries, she is going to be drinking more and more and more and more from Satan's golden cup. And I believe, I lean towards this, that I think massive global prosperity is coming. I know that's hard to believe with all that's going on in the world right now, but I think this thing is going to turn around, and I think America is going to become very wealthy. And I think the Middle East is going to become very wealthy, and Saudi Arabia is already very wealthy, and I think the whole world is going to benefit from peace in the Middle East. And I think that massive global prosperity is coming. Laodicea, as I've said, is already buzzed right now, but I think Satan is going to buy her a few more shots. And we are going to see the Bride of Christ get completely wasted, in alcoholic terms, through what? More words and more wealth. Remember that verse in Isaiah 19:14 that caused the deceiving spirit caused Egypt to err, and it staggered around like a drunken man in his vomit? That spirit of deception, when everything you do is wrong, that's likened to being drunk. And in the last days of the church, you look around at modern Christianity, everything, they can't get anything right. They don't even have the right Bible. They've got messed up doctrine. They've got messed up Bibles. They're tolerating all kinds of sin and saying that sin is okay. Everything they do is completely backwards. You say, what is that? That's likened to being drunk. The church is drunk. When Jesus returns, the church is in real bad shape. And Jesus is essentially the designated driver who has to take her home. And she's going to have to sober up before the marriage supper of the Lamb. And if you know your Bible, the judgment seat of Christ will do just that. That'll sober her up real good. So Christian, beware of Satan's strong drink. You say, what is that? It's wealth. If you have a King James Bible and you're a Bible believer, you might not get swayed by the flattery, the words, the false teachings, and the